let's continue with the program. The next speaker is René Janssen. He's from Eindhoven University and also connected to Differ by means of a joint group on solar fuels. René is the winner of the Spinoza Prize this year, so it was a very good choice, I think, especially also because of the connection with Differ, of course. But honestly, it should be said that, of course, he got this career award, I would say, for all the work he did on polymeric solar cells within the Eindhoven University. So part of his research focuses nowadays still on plastic solar cells and the storage of solar energy in solar fuels.
Yep. Thank you very much, Richard. Congratulations for the opening today. And it's indeed a pleasure for me to be able to tell something about the work that we have been doing on polymer solar cells and how this is now transforming and trying to see if we can also use this in the area of solar fuels. So given the title of my talk is Capturing Solar Energy in Charges and in Bonds with Organic Semiconductors. And if we look at this image, this is an image on this campus, just a few hundred meters away from there. It is taken a few months earlier in the summer, and you can see a beautiful landscape, trees, water, air. And what is really happening here is that we are making fossil fuels, just a bit slow. This is the most important chemical reaction on the planet. This is the only process by which we can live, get food, get heated, get our power. This is a reaction that we should be cherishing to some extent, in the sense that we do not only like to look at a nice natural landscape, but that also the sugars that we make, the oxygen that it brings, and the carbon dioxide that it consumes are vital for our society. If you look a little bit more in detail how this happens, how this beautiful reaction happens, then in the middle of the photosynthetic reaction center is what is called the special pair of chlorophyll molecules, and they are depicted here in red. And get excited by light, and then in the excited state transfer an electron to a nearby quinone molecule, that is this one here, and thereby you create a charge separated state, a state where there's a hole on one side and an electron on the other side, much like you can do in a silicon semiconductor also by exciting light. And these this charge separated state, the oxidized chlorophyll and the reduced quinone set off chemical reactions that in the end produce oxidized water and reduced carbon dioxide producing sugars. The energy efficiency, though, of natural photosynthesis is really low. In general, it's much less than 1%. And that makes that having biomass as a full source of energy will be competing always and strongly with the need of having food for our society. So we'll need to find a way to get to better and more efficient production of solar fuels. Now, if you look at the molecules that are part of these of this photosynthetic reaction center, then this is an image of how it really works. It's a beautiful array of chlorophyll molecules that are all made to transfer the excitation energy to this special pair here, these red molecules, and there this reaction happens. And it is governed by all these other chlorophyll molecules and these yellow carotene molecules. And if you look at these molecules, they are part of a structure where you see alternating single and double bonds. And that is a typical structure where you can have delocalized charges inside the molecule. You basically make a small semiconductor molecule. And this idea was also recognized already a long time ago and has led to the development of what is known as semiconducting polymers. Polymers, materials that are based on organic materials, organic compounds that are able to absorb light to conduct charges. And the credit here goes especially to these winners of the Nobel Prize 15 years ago that discovered polyacetylene in the 70s. Actually, in the year when I finished my high school, they published this discovery and showed that when you dope polyacetylene with iodine, you can increase its conductivity by orders of magnitude to the levels that are equal to copper. As yet, all these years later, we know that our our electricity wires are not still made from polymers. They are made from copper still. Or other metals. And the reason for that is this polyacetylene, as you can see in this vial, it is not very stable in air, and it will actually ignite as soon as you open the bottle. So that's not good news, but in the meantime, a lot of research has happened, and of course, and now we have semiconducting polymers that are very stable, that absorb, can emit light, that can transport charges, and that you can dissolve in organic solvents to make thin films. And basically, what you have generated in this way is a liquid semiconductor, a semiconductor that you can paint, spray, print in any form, in any shape, to give it any function. And this has led to a lot of technological developments already. Printed electronics, light-emitting diodes that are flexible, displays, and also, more recently, solar cells. Polymer solar cells in which the organic compounds are the heart of the layer that generates or that converts light into electricity, into electrical power. And the way that happens is by what we call a bulk heterojunction, is a combination of two semiconductors. Here I show two examples of a semiconducting polymer and a fullerene derivative, this being the donor and the acceptor. And when you mix these into an active layer, you can create charges at the interface as soon as the photon is absorbed there. And this creates charges that you can collect at two electrodes and use organic materials now not as nature does to do chemical reactions, but to create electrical power. And this is a kind of a molecular scale image. Here you see the conducting polymer chain, getting light, creating charges, transferring electron. The electron hops via different molecules to the other side of the material. The charges move along the chain or in between chains. And this is a molecular scale image. This is an image of how it looks on a slightly larger than molecular scale, or how it could look like, because we don't really know exactly how this morphology is on the molecular scale. On a slightly larger scale, we know it from TEM images. And what is very important in making these in these layers is the way how you make it, how you make the morphology. So we typically start from such a semiconductor ink with two materials in there. We try to make a film, but the way that you make the film can be very different. This is just exactly the same material made via a very slight difference of the processing conditions. And this has a very poor efficiency with large phase separation of the two materials. This is a very narrow phase separation between the two materials, which gives much more interface and much more charge generation and a much more efficient material. And exactly figuring out how to do this has been a point of some recent studies of ours. And if you do this well and develop the right materials, then you can slowly push the efficiency. This is a result of a few years ago where efficiencies of around 7% for conversion were obtained. It's not the highest efficiency, of course, in photovoltaic, but it's an efficiency based on very simple and scalable materials. You can do this at the efficiency here around 7%, and here from the picture on the right you can see the quantum efficiency as function of wavelengths, and you can see that we're already covering a significant part of the solar spectrum for this material. And developments in our group have been mainly on trying to develop new materials that are indeed able to cover a larger part of the spectrum. So we're pushing this from 800 to 900 to 1000, and efficiencies remain quite high in these ranges, at least for organic solar cells. Even more recently, we have been able to push the absorption to higher wavelengths, and in the end reach materials that are comparable in band gap to silicon. At these points, the efficiency starts to drop a little bit, but at least we can use a larger part of the solar spectrum, which is very useful for what we really want to do, and that is use these materials in more efficient devices in tandem solar cells. And I'll show that in a minute. This is kind of the development worldwide. If you look at from around 2000 to nowadays, there has been a significant increase in efficiency, now going up to 12%, numbers that we didn't think were possible when we started around 2000. And I'm sure that this curve, although it's a bit erratic, will continue to increase. And also technologically-wise, there's a lot of developments to make small panels already, and also larger panels that show that this technology is not only something for the lab scale, but is definitely able to go to higher areas in the future. And this was developed here in Eindhoven at the Holst Center. A center Which we, as a collaboration between TNO and IMEC, with which we are collaborating within this Alliance framework. I was just mentioning already that we are trying to make these materials especially to come to multi-junction devices where we stack more of these materials to more efficiently use the solar spectrum. The solar spectrum is composed of low energy photons, of high energy photons, and you can use them better when you can use these photons more individually. So we try here to separate the spectrum in a small band gap, giving the white of the small band gap giving the low energy photons, and the wide band gap material giving the high energy photons, collecting the high energy photons, and by that you can in overall get a higher collection efficiency in terms of energy. And we think that if we are with 11% on a single junction, as we call it, we could push this to 15% in a tandem junction. We are not that far, but I'll show you later that we are getting close to it, or closer to these numbers. This is a somewhat earlier work a few years ago where we had two single junction cells and made from these materials. And if you stack them, you can make a tandem cell out of this. And the real trick that we had to play here is how to stack these layers. It seems very easy to stack a few layers, but you have to remind that these are all processed from inks. So you push one ink over another ink, over another ink, over another ink. And all these layers have very defined thicknesses in the order of the thinnest layer is something like 30 nanometer. The thickest layer is something like 150 nanometers. And these have to be defined. And you have to make sure that one layer doesn't wash away the previous layer or the previous deposited layer. And even after a few layers, you still have to make sure that all these layers are consistent. And that is a trick that we kind of developed how to do this. And we now can stack basically an unlimited amount of cells. The highest number we stacked so far was 6 of these cells. And then you have something like 18 solution process layers on top of each other. That works pretty nicely. And here you can see a TM cross-section image of such a cell where you can see the glass and ITO substrate on which we make it. And then the first polymer conducting layer, the small band gap material. Actually, this should be the wide band gap material. The mistake is still there. I thought I corrected this. But and this is the wide band gap, the small band gap cells. So these should be switched. In between, we have a recombination layer, which takes care of the recombination of charges that are formed in this layer and in this layer to sustain the current, but do this recombination without any loss of energy. And that helps to create a better performing cell. And then you can actually calculate just if you do the right modeling, you can calculate what the cell should be, and that is the dotted line. And if we make the cell, it gives the solid line, and is exactly what we predicted. And here I show the quantum efficiencies, where you can really see that both parts of the solar spectrum are used, and indeed the red part is absorbed by the red cell, and the blue part is absorbed by what we call the blue cell, or indeed it's colored in red because the material looks red, but that has to do with the reflection and absorption of light being complementary. So the cell is able to use a larger part of the spectrum and still give a higher efficiency of close to 9% compared to the 6% that we had in the single junctions. You can even stack a further layer on this top of this and then get to efficiencies close to 10%. And that uses the fact that this small band gap material produces so much current that we can actually distribute it over two cells and then get the extra voltage of that cell. So there's all kind of tricks to be played there to slowly increase the efficiency. And also, if you look into other people's work and collect everything, then you see that these are the graphs that are emerging here. But for sure, the tandem and triple junctions will at some point go beyond the single junctions. The single junctions now highest at 11.3, the tandems highest at 10.8, and the triples now at highest at 11.8. Coming to efficiencies that are still away from efficiencies that you would need to compete with the traditional technologies, but on the other hand, are not so far away that it is an idea on which you should not work. A recent example of even higher efficiency we reached together with colleagues in Delft in the group of Arno Smets and Miro Zeeman was a very talented PhD student who recently moved to Canada, but he and Alice Furlan and my group were able to make a triple junction amorphous silicon polymer solar cells that use three parts of the solar spectrum in different cell layers. This is the polymer layer, and this is the, yeah, it's difficult to see, but this is the tandem structure of two silicon cells, and get to efficiencies over 13%. So this shows how far you can push this. This is an image inspired on a slide that I once saw from Richard, where you can see where we have solar energy. These are the dark parts here on our planet. As you can see, Eindhoven area is not particularly known for solar energy. Actually, look, if you look on the map of Europe, you can see that Eindhoven is really a dip. It's kind of the sink point of solar energy. Or maybe it's therefore the place where you should work the hardest on it. So that is the And this is the place where you can see where light is at night, and yeah, it's difficult to see, but Eindhoven is the city of light, and that's where you can see this very bright spot here in the middle. So now this shows that electricity is not only needed at points when we don't need it, when not only can be generated at times when we might not need it as much as at other times, so day and night rhythm, but there is also a positional difference where there's most solar energy, we use electricity the least as a global society, and the other way around. So this calls for solar fuels. And this is a nice sentence that you can read in a paper. I'll show you the citation in a minute. This is to fix solar energy through suitable photochemical reactions with new compounds that master the photochemical process that hitherto have been guarded as secrets of plants. A bit old-fashioned English. That's true, because this was published exactly 100 years or 103 years ago by Italian scientist Chamichan, and he published this sentence in this article in Science, and called his contribution "The Photochemistry of the Future." And honestly, we have been 100 years since then, but in my view, too little has happened with his prophecy, and that's what we should do in the next century, I guess. So if you think about artificial leaves, how can you do something that is similar to natural systems? And coming back to the photosynthesis that I started with, how can you convert sunlight into energetic bonds? And then still you need to absorb the light, you have to make some kind of charges, and then you have to have a catalytic process that either converts water into hydrogen or carbon dioxide into methanol or similar reactions. Of course, these are not the only two reactions that you could think of. There are many of them that you could think of. And these tandem solar cells that I showed you before are actually capable of doing that, because they allow you to make cells that have enough potential to split water electrochemically. So you can make electrochemical generated directly from a solar cell. And that's what we have been trying to push a little bit in terms of how can you interface such an organic solar cell with this hydrogen production. And we came up with this design that we now stack such a triple-layer junction solar cell. We interconnect it with catalytic areas. We can use different type of catalyst on a titanium substrate here. And this is a way of doing it. A slightly different, more integrated way is this one, where we have here a triple junction solar cell. You can see the green color. It actually looks like a green leaf. This somewhat darker part behind this is the aluminum back electrode. And these are in one device connected to catalysts that are here on deposited on ITO. And if we shine light from the front, it produces hydrogen and oxygen with a reasonable efficiency, at least for these first examples. So these are the IV curves that belong to it. This is the red curve here is the IV curve of the solar cell. The blue curve is the curve of the cell that if you just throw it into water, it will run along this line. As this line is the kind of temporal change that is here shown as time. So you get current, you develop the voltage, and after something like 15 minutes, this is stabilized. And at that point, we have a not very high, but at least a 5 times higher efficiency with these organic materials than nature is achieving in in natural photosynthesis. It was just published last week online, and it's a pity that the Secretary of State is not here anymore, because it's open access publication, so you can all look it up. Now, we are pretty happy with this first result, and of course, what we will try and what is really necessary to do in the next time is to make this, first of all, more efficient, and especially to try and use this and make integrated systems that really, and that I didn't go in all the details, but to get to make the system such that the maximum power point of your solar cell coincides with the potential where you can split the water efficiently requires that you balance the solar cell exactly to the catalyst that you need. And you need to make sure that the rate at which the photons come in is exactly the same rate at which you can produce the chemicals. And if these rates are unbalanced, your system will deteriorate in efficiency very rapidly. So that's very important. So natural photosynthesis, efficiency below 1%, artificial leaves with organic materials higher than 6%. If you look at there's a few other examples that we have. But I showed you the 5% example. We have also a 6% example. If you look into the literature, of course, with high efficiency solar cells, you can reach already efficiencies that are close to 18%. But I think that these are less amenable for scale up. And for real scale for the future, we need all kind of materials. We need good metal oxide, semiconductors maybe, for both absorbing light, but also to create charges. We need better catalysts, maybe molecular catalysts. We need selective reduction methods to get carbon dioxide, maybe to CO if we want to use carbon dioxide. And all this has to be based on Earth abundant elements and materials, and that is, I think, is a great challenge. All the things that we want to do, I think, somehow technically we can achieve already, but we cannot achieve it on a scale that is really necessary to make a real contribution to the energy demand of our planet. And so we think that with these organic materials, we can push this to efficiencies at least in the order of above 15% for the organic solar cells, and values that are very similar actually for the solar fuel production. And this is not a theoretical calculation based on fundamental deep understanding. What is going is kind of a practical way of looking at it, and these numbers are no means to be taken as the ultimate limits, but more as the challenges that we see for the next few years. After that, and they are challenging numbers, and I think that after that we have to really think harder to see where we can lose less energy and use more of the solar spectrum. So efficiencies in organic solar cells are approaching, are over 10%, are approaching the 15% that we are hoping to get. Solar water splitting is I think, quickly catching up. I won't be surprised that in a few years we have these efficiencies close to 10% as well. And then we have to see how to push it in further directions. So I think that is for the future, and that we will see in the next few years. I think it's nice to stop at the Chamichan's Differ Institute. This was 100 years ago. This is Chamichan standing here on the balcony in Bologna. He is at the University of Bologna. And if you look a little bit more carefully, you can see all his experiments here. All these bottles here on the balcony are shaping the future 100 years ago. And that's why I'm very happy. This looks a bit grayish and this looks a bit old. That's why I'm very happy that we have this building now. And I congratulate my colleagues here at DIFR and hope you have a great time.
Thank you, René, for your talk. A very nice talk and inspiration also. Questions? In the back, yes.
Molf in Amsterdam. So, René, comparing a conventional silicon photovoltaic system with an organic one, yeah. Silicon PV can now reach 25%. And the reason that a solar panel based on silicon is so cheap is that the cost of the solar cell is really much less than the cost of the system. So efficiency is really a very important parameter. Yeah. And I'm just curious now, comparing to, if I would just compare silicon PV with organic, then you have a problem, right? Unless you can make very good systems. So is there a way an organic solar panel can be made in a very inexpensive way?
Yes and no. Yes, in the future, and no, not now. No, I think you have to be very honest on these things. So if we go back at this organic solar cell work started 15 years ago, at a time that the silicon solar energy was not unable to get into the market because of its price. So at that point, the main driver was organic solar cells will be able to do this at a lower cost. And because you can print them roll to roll, you can produce them in principle at meters per second, which is for silicon technology not so easy. So that was the original driver. Of course, since then, the price of silicon solar panels has gone down enormously by a factor of 10, and that was at that time not really foreseen, I guess. So the main motivation, I think, for organic solar cells to be more cost-effective than traditional silicon panels, I think that is something that now is not true. It might be true in the future because still the technology is very simple. But if you look at what you have to do now, you cannot make a solar panel with the same efficiency for the price that you pay for the same silicon panel. But still there are companies, startup companies, they are now installing outside in the open air organic solar cells for first test sites. And so we have to see how that develops. The organic solar cells, despite maybe the fact that in terms of price performance, they will not reach the level of silicon solar cells soon. The other advantage is that they are flexible, they are shapeable, they are colorable. You can have them in any color. And I think that is an asset that can be used, especially in the first years, to make something in building integrated PV where the architect not only wants to see a nice building and a nice energy, or not only wants to see nice energy, but also wants to see a nice building and wants to use specifically that element, that you can shape it, that you can give it a color that you like, that you even can make transparent ones. So we make transparent solar cells where we use the fact that these materials can absorb in the IR, but are transparent, invisible, and still you have a solar cell that is transparent to light, to visible light. It is maybe a bit grayish, but it absorbs the IR part and converts the IR part. So I think there's plenty of opportunity still for that. Although I agree that silicon technology is a beautiful technology, and any beautiful and good technology is hard to beat.
Okay, thanks.
Other questions? Yes, in the back also.
Victor Landvom. I have another question about efficiency, but of fuels, and I'm a little confused because the efficiency of a fuel depends very much on how efficiently you burn it. Yeah. Is it even fair to compare the sugar in trees with the hydrogen we need to burn in, say, a car?
No. So what I take as the hydrogen efficiency is that we assume that we can that the if you burn the hydrogen, you get the full energy back. So that is the way that the heat of combustion of hydrogen compared to the heat of combustion of sugar. That is how you compare it. And then nature is just not doing a very good job. There's a few reasons for it. You can actually see nowadays why have all the nice trees no leaves anymore, because the trees are unable to sustain in wintertime with the light intensity that is here in Eindhoven. Indeed, that is not very high. Are unable to sustain their life. They have come into a system, they have developed in a system where they hibernate in winter and survive through the winter by not doing anything and blossom up again in spring. And of course, we love the spring and it's very nice, but if a plant would be really efficient, it would have leaves all year long. And photosynthesis is actually, it's not very an efficient process energy-wise. It is, of course, very efficient in all the other things that it does. It pleases us. It gives us food. It is the most beautiful and most complex, I think, reaction system in our planet, in the world. We should cherish it and not wait until it forms fossil fuels and burn them.
Another question. Maybe I have a question, René. So your in your talk, you were actually showing the results on a fully integrated, let's say, solar cell into a solar fuels device. How do you think, let's say, the developments will go? Will it be solar power generating electricity, then electricity with electrolysis generating fuels? Or what is the, let's say, the key? Because
I know what you mean. Do you want to make an integrated system? Do you want to have it at different locations? And I think it's very difficult to predict that. Huh? Mm-hmm. Of course, you would say, now why don't we make a big installation of solar panels and at some point put a electrolyzer? But now think of that at some point we are going to change carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is as distributed as a solar light. So if we are going to put panels on our roof for getting, or in our garden or somewhere, to have to harvest the solar light, we need the same areas also to get the carbon dioxide out of the air, maybe. So it's very difficult to predict this. Of course, my dream is a little bit that we have at some point we have a photovoltaic system where indeed we put water tap on one side, it runs over our roof, and then on the other side we plug the natural gas that comes out of it back into the grid, or store it in some tank below our house or something, or make a fuel out of it and burn it again in winter when we burn our stove, burn it again, get the CO2 directly from that stove and store it again and use it in the summer to. These are all possible. You can bring this on a small scale. You can bring it on a large scale. I think the future will tell us what will happen. I cannot predict this. And I have also not a real direct view on this, what will happen. I think we should explore all these possibilities and see what in the end is technically possible. And there's a lot of technical possibilities. What in the end will roll out as being the most important thing is the one that is also economically feasible, because that will get the head start, like silicon solar cells have a head start. That's why organic solar cells have a difficulty to match up with them, but one day they might or will. Okay. We'll see.
Good. Is there another, maybe final question? Looking around. Yes.
René, I was wondering, you still use ITO?
Yes. In our cells,
entirely green.
That is not entirely green, if you like. To show. So ITO is used indeed in our cells as the front contact, but it's not really necessary. If I show you this image from Hall Center, you can actually see here a honeycomb lattice where they use a metal and a semiconductor and a conducting polymer for the front electrode. So this is an ITO-free cell. There's no ITO here. At this point, the grid is made of silver, but it can also be made of copper. And now then you are getting closer to something where there is no indium anymore into the transparent electrode. From a lab scale point of view, it's easier to use all these nice metal oxides for your cell making. But definitely on large scale, people are getting away from ITO.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So, there's no final question. Then I would like to thank René again for his very nice presentation.
Yeah. And thank you.
I also have a small token of appreciation.
Thank you very much.
Yes, it's the goodie bag of DIFA.